Check, 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 check. Sorry, I couldn't resist. It was on my coach, along with my hat and my other Oilers jersey. And I said, I have to wear that to church today. Maybe the last chance. However, as Jordan told me, there is hope. And much like us Christians, you know, the difference between us and the world is we have hope, right? Isn't it the truth? And now the Oilers also have a little bit of hope. So anyways, welcome to Banff Park Church this morning. Of course, for those of you who are here and online, I know my daughter Jacqueline, who called me for Father's Day today from Texas, said, I'll be watching you. So Jacqueline, I don't want to disappoint. You know, thank you for tuning in. Excellent. So Greg's had a rather rough week this week. He said he had the death plague, but I thought I saw him and he looked alive to me. Now, I'm no doctor, but I just thought he would. Happy Father's Day again to all of you fathers out there. Remember, as celebrating Father's Day, we have cookies at the back, Dad's cookies, and beer. And, oh, hold on, I got that wrong. Root beer. Sorry, there you go. Yeah, what a screw up. Oh, sorry. Okay. Anyways, do we want to go back and talk about the Oilers game last night again or anything? No? Randy and Randy are both going, don't do it. No, okay, we won't. So, but I will tell you that July is coming and it will soon be time to take the snow tires off your car. Looking out at the fresh snow on the mountains this morning, typically it's really pretty and it's really nice. I got up this morning and says, that sucks. You know, it's just a little bit too cold for me. Went golfing the other day, and it is hard to putt when you can't feel your hands. You know, you just sort of, it doesn't go well anyways. And Randy McLean will tell you that for sure. Actually, even on warm days, that's true. So, sorry, had to throw you under the bus there. Randy's been known to three putt one or two times. And as I say, Sharon's got a new book out. It's how to line up your fourth putt. Anyways, sorry. Sometimes I just get carried away. Greg's always at the back going, why do we give him the mic? I don't know. Anyways. Good one. I'm a loud talker, though. I could probably get away with it. But anyways. So as we near the end of June, we have to be in prayer for our children as they finish up their school year. Things will change. They graduate to another year. They're getting older. And I think when we're praying for the children, we should also pray for their parents who will have to put them up at home, put up with them at home every day. But it is truly, you know, a time of transition for them in our school system and their lives. So remember them in your prayers as well. We need a couple of people to help with our audio visual at the back. If you'd like to learn how to do that, and I'm sort of thinking of the younger adults who are tech savvy, if you want to learn a little bit about that, there's no hope for us older guys. But if you want to help out, please come and see us and give us a hand with that. Because as people go on holidays and different things happen, we could always use more people that know what's going on down there. Wednesday is our monthly general board meeting. So again, please pray for our board as we seek God's will. And it gets confusing. You know, you have your own will and your own desire and your own thoughts. And sometimes we turn to focus on those. And our prayer is that we don't turn to ourselves, but we turn to Him and His will be done, not ours. And if you're new to Banff Park Church and have not received our welcome package yet, please come and see me or any of the board members, and we will organize getting that to you. Lots of information of how to get plugged in and where to go to join our different groups. And again, you know, every week I say we have, you know, men's group, we have ladies study groups, we have young adults, very active and supporting groups that you may want to be involved in. Tuesdays at Soup, we can always use help there as well. So if you'd like to come on in and have some great soup, homemade, please do that. The food bank is also here that day. And so join in, come sit, talk, and enjoy a bowl of soup as well. So those are our announcements today. And we have our scripture reading. That is, my phone always goes blank. Just as I turn to my phone, sure shooting, it goes to screensaver. And anyways, but it is Psalm 121, 1 to 8. And it reads, I lift my eyes up to the hills. From where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. So as we switch gears now, and you hear me often say, because it goes for me as much as anyone, to put the busyness of the week and all of the stuff that's going on in our busy lives aside, and now open our hearts and our minds, prepare ourselves to hear what Scripture says to us this morning, and we'll just sort of calm ourselves and try to forget about hockey. It's tough, but I'm gonna do my very best. All right, let's sort of change gears and let's pray. If you'll bow with me, please. Lord, can't start without saying thanks. You are an awesome God, and we are your children, and you have blessed us. We have so much, Lord, to be thankful for. As we look around us and we look at what we have, and there are many in the world that don't have a safe, warm place to sleep. They don't have abundance of food, and they're worried about not even tomorrow, they're worried about today. And Lord, we thank you and give you the credit that we don't have those problems, but we pray for those who do. Lord, we pray that you are here and speaking to us in a powerful way. Open our minds, give us calm hearts. Let us hear what you have to say this morning. We just got to say thanks, Lord. We are so fortunate. So be with us again, Lord. Keep us safe. Be with those traveling and visitors here as well. We pray all of these things in your precious name, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, and now if we can have our worship team. I don't know if we have a team.
We do.
We have a team. We have a team today. Thanks.
Good morning, everybody. It's so nice to be standing up here singing with you guys. Just wanted you to know that. Sorry, that was loud. But you guys have to stand. If I have to stand, you have to stand. Huh? This might be my last time leading music here.
You'll be fine.
But, you know, we could do, I could be a visiting musician. I could be a visiting musician. Okay. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
I'm
right down front.
Oh, your mercy never fails me. I've been held in your hands from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. I will sing of the goodness of God.
I'm not afraid to
can have a seat for this last song.
Team, you always are great, never fail us, so thank you, it's awesome, except Jordan's moving away, so you have to come back as a guest singer, guitar player, but don't worry, it's only every week, okay, so it's okay, but you know, I was talking about Father's Day, and I talked about my daughter Jacqueline down in Texas, and I would be remiss in not mentioning her husband David, which I forgot. So, David, hi, sorry. Messed up, short memory, like me. Anyways, kids, Sunday school. 3, 2, 1. Okay, we'll see you after the service. Enjoy. Don't forget, after the service next, we also have snacks and things next door. So please come and join us and be over there. And now I'd like to invite Greg to come. Oh, offering. Okay. Come on up, guys. Like, my thing here says, and it was just sent to me very recently, that Greg is coming up. So no one told me anything different. But we are going to do our offering. And we are grateful, you know, in doing so that we do have money and stuff that we can give. And, you know, our offering may not be money. It may be our time. It may be our testimony. It may be just speaking to our family and our friends and our coworkers. Maybe that's our offering. My biggest fear is that people don't come to church, and I've said this before, because they think we want their money. That's not true. Jesus doesn't need your money. He wants your heart. So as we prepare to give, let's remember that. And there's no sin and there's no shame in allowing the tray to pass. And but when you have the opportunity, we are called to share his good news. So let's do that. Let's pray for our offering. Thank you, Lord. Again, I just can't start a prayer to you without saying thanks. We are so fortunate, and I take it for granted, Lord, that you are there protecting me and standing beside me and helping me and helping me with my decisions and being in everything in my life, Lord, and I invite you into that, Lord. And Lord, all that you've given me, wow, you know, you are an awesome God. And now, Lord, as we prepare to just give a little bit back to you, we pray that you bless this offering. Bless the givers, Lord. And as a church and as a board, we use it wisely to further your name and your kingdom. So, Lord, please just now bless these gifts that we give back to you. Thank you for all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. So I really don't know what's going to happen next, and I'm the MC. I should know. The chairman of the board might know. Oh. See, he's going to do it on there. All right, okay. Great, Greg's coming to us by Zoom. Thanks.
The first kind of 33 verses of Acts chapter 10 are about a guy named Cornelius and the Apostle Peter. And what we see is God's sovereignty at work in both the life of Cornelius to draw him to the Lord, to draw him to Jesus, and Peter to understand that what he already knows, that the Gentiles are going to become part of the church, the implications of what that means has not been clear to him. And so there's still kind of a disconnect for Peter there. And so we looked at last week, God used Cornelius to help Peter and Peter to help Cornelius the way that God often does. Cornelius is a God-fearing man, well-respected by the Jews, serves the one true God, but doesn't know who Jesus is, at least not yet. And this morning we're going to see the short sermon that Peter preaches and how that impacts him and how he comes to faith and how the Gentiles are going to come into the church to be united together. Peter had this vision of a big sheet kind of descending down with all these different animals on it, and the voice in the vision said, take, kill, and eat. And he says, no, I've never eaten anything unclean. And the voice says, what God has made clean, don't call unclean, or do not call common, rather. And what we begin to see here is that Peter doesn't quite figure it out just yet, but on the journey to go back to Cornelius, he figures it out, that God accepts everyone. But there's a caveat for that, and this is the thing that we talked about a lot last week, is while Christ's sacrifice on the cross, his death and resurrection, is sufficient to pay the penalty for all sin and sufficient to welcome us into fellowship with God, there is something that we have to do, and that something is repentance. We have to confess our sin. We have to turn from our sin and seek to follow Jesus. And we looked at how in the New Testament it talks about God's goal for us is to become more like Christ. And in our culture, we've kind of switched it. And it's more like God's so loving, he just welcomes you in as you are. And you could just be who you are, be your one true authentic self. That kind of idea. But actually what the scriptures teach is come to God with all your hurts, with all your brokenness, with all the sin and the damage that sin has done. Repent of that, and Jesus will restore you, and the Holy Spirit will indwell you, and you will become more like Christ as we submit to the Spirit. And so it's not a sense of we come to Christ and he just accepts us as we are. We come to Christ and he radically changes us. And that's what we're going to talk about a little bit this morning, too, is have we radically been changed, or have we just become a follower of Jesus, but our life hasn't changed? Because then I wonder, are we actually following Jesus? So that's last week. So let's read together here. This morning we're going to read two different sections. We're going to read verse 34 of chapter 10 to the end of the chapter. We're going to talk about that. And then we're going to quickly go over the next 18 verses of chapter 11, which is kind of a repeat. It's going to sound very familiar to last week, but it's God's word, and I don't want to skip over any of it. So we are going to read it together, but let's focus on these first few verses first. So starting in 34. So Peter opened his mouth and said, truly, I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus, peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and made him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him, all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. While Peter was saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. For they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, "Can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked him to remain for some days. It's a pretty telling story here. For a bunch of different reasons, but let's just walk our way through it just a little bit here. This first verse, the grammar in the ESV might be a little tricky, so I looked it up in the NIV and it says this: Peter began to speak, "I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation who fear him and do what is right." And that's what we talked about last week, is God does accept us and welcome us in, but we have to repent, and then he radically changes us. So we need to repent, which is fear him, and we need to live for him, which is do what is right. The thing that I think is important for us to note, though, is Peter isn't saying to Cornelius, because you were seeking God, God has accepted you. Welcome into the family of God. Rather, what he's saying is, Cornelius, because you are seeking God, God is going to reward that seeking. We talked about that last week in Hebrews, that God diligently rewards those who seek him. But so now God's going to, through Peter, have the gospel declared, the gospel of Jesus, so that Cornelius can be forgiven of his sin and brought into the family of God. Peter begins this, it's kind of a mini sermon. I'm certain that Luke doesn't record the whole thing here, but the necessary parts for us to see. And so Peter says, right, that you yourselves know, Cornelius, being a follower of the one true God, was aware of the historical realities of Jesus, who he was and what he did. But for Peter, there's something very important. It's not just intellectual knowledge that's important. It's a relational knowledge that's important. In fact, Paul, in Philippians 3, verses 10 to 11, says it this way: that I may know him, that's Jesus, and the power of his resurrection, and that I may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Is he wants to know Christ, not just about Christ, but he wants to share in everything, the joys and the triumphs, but the persecution as well, even death itself. That's the intimate knowledge that Paul talks about there and that Peter wants to have clear to Cornelius. I gotta be honest, this is really tricky to do on the computer after so many years, so pardon me for this little pause here. Cornelius has heard about all that Jesus did. Peter is now seeking to not only confirm those things, but to make it personal. Peter tells him that it's not just hypothetical, because he was there. He saw, he witnessed the resurrection of Jesus. He witnessed the teaching of Jesus. He witnessed post-cross Jesus, and not just him, but many others. In fact, in this little sermon here, scholars point out that Peter focuses a little more time here on this excuse me, on this idea of resurrection body than the other sermons that we've read so far. And probably the reason for that is, to the Jews, that was not a new concept. And we talked about this a number of months ago. Some of the religious leaders rejected that there was a resurrection, but the concept was there, and many of the Jews believed in it. To the Gentiles, this was likely a brand new thing. This idea that you were welcomed into the family of God, but that you would get a resurrection body, that you would be restored to perfection with Jesus in eternity. It's so much more than just saved from here and now, but saved for eternity. And then Peter says that Jesus then commissioned those like himself who bore witness, who were there. In fact, he doesn't even say commissioned here, he says commanded. He commanded the disciples to preach that Jesus is the one who will be the final judge. Now, here's the thing. Again, it's said that Jesus is the judge. What will Jesus judge the world based on? Based on sin. Now, if you have accepted Christ as your Savior, if you've confessed Jesus as Lord, believed in your heart that God raised him from the dead, then you are part of this family. And that means that your sin has not only been forgiven, but Jesus' righteousness has been imputed into you, which means on Jesus' behalf, when God sees us, he sees Jesus' righteousness, not our own sin. And so we get to share in that, which is impossible to truly grasp, but is a beautiful truth. And I don't know how, if we know that, how we wouldn't share that. I understand that sometimes there's fear, that sometimes there's persecution. But if we really understand salvation, what Jesus has saved us from and what he has saved us for, then this is where that radical change comes in. I might be shy, I might be nervous, I might be scared, I might fill in the blank. But I submit to the power of the Holy Spirit, and he uses me to accomplish his purposes, not because of my gifts or talents or abilities, but because I've been changed, because I'm not who I was anymore. And this is one of the things about today's world that is so different to the scriptures, is the focus here on our world is you are who you are and you should be proud of that. And the scriptures are, you are who you are and yet God has saved you. He saved you from that, from the power of sin, from the consequences of sin, and he's radically changing you to become more like him. He's going to judge the world. And Peter wraps up this verse 43 by saying, everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sin through his name. This should remind us back to Acts 4, verse 12. Which we looked at back in the beginning of March. It says there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. It's only through Jesus that we're saved. But we can have the confidence that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness. Now, this is where that believes in him. Do we know Christ or do we just know about him? We want to know him. Peter's relatively small sermon here is in keeping with the other sermons he preached in Acts so far, except there are some slight differences as he preaches to a new audience, a Gentile audience, one that he's probably not fully prepared and doesn't fully understand all the implications to yet. But what happens here in verse 44 is really meant to surprise us and maybe shock us. And again, I think for the first century Jew and Gentile person reading a text like this, it would have done that. We live so far removed from that, sometimes maybe we don't see it. But Luke writes that while Peter was still saying these things, while Peter's still... excuse me. while Peter is still explaining the gospel of Jesus, it says the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. While Peter's still talking, the Spirit descends and indwells this group of Gentile people. And I think it's really interesting to think about this in this first century context, and the details that Luke gives us here is the group of Gentiles, the six men with Peter, are shocked by what happens. I guess my question is, haven't they been sitting there listening to Peter preach? Haven't they heard that God doesn't show favoritism? Do they agree with him? Do they disagree? Are they upset with Peter for what he's preaching? Or do they agree in theory, but like Peter, have not yet fully understood its implications? There's something very significant and important here for us to see. And this is going to last for a few more chapters yet. We're going to read a little bit more of that in the next chapter. So before we get there, though, scholars refer to this as the Gentile Pentecost. So just like in Acts 2, when the Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost and indwelled all the believers and they began to speak in other languages, the exact same thing happens here. And it's interesting. John Polhill has a really, I've quoted him lots in his commentaries for Acts because he's got some really good insights. But he says this: only an undeniable demonstration of divine power could overrule all these Jewish objections to the Gentiles coming to faith. God provided precisely that in Cornelius's home. We're going to see that as we read chapter 11 in just a few moments here. Is that for the Gentiles to come in, this wasn't to come into the church. This wasn't just going to happen a little bit here and a little bit there. There was going to be a big moment. And that's why the scholars call this Gentile Pentecost. Is it's the exact same thing. Maybe not quite to the same scope initially, but certainly is about to spread like crazy. This text is meant to help us see that there's no difference between the Jews and the Gentiles. That the cross of Jesus unifies us together as men and women, born in different places, different cultures, different backgrounds. And yet God doesn't discriminate based on that. God welcomes us all in. Well, he invites us all in. But then it's up to us to repent. Peter witnesses the Holy Spirit coming on them, and his response is beautiful. In fact, there's a kind of a nerdy detail here in the Greek that should remind us back to the Ethiopian eunuch in chapter 8. In both these instances, the question that gets asked is, what prevents them from being baptized? In other words, what prevents their full inclusion into the family of God? We can't just watch the Holy Spirit come on them and go, oh, I guess they're saved. They need to almost, in a sense, confirm that, welcome them in. And so Peter says, okay, we got to baptize them. Like, and so he kind of says, like, who can withhold water for baptism? And then notice the last bit of what he says there. They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have. There's no distinction any longer. Now, Peter doesn't fully yet get that. Or maybe more accurate to say is he's going to forget that as we go forward in the text in the coming weeks ahead. But for this moment anyway, he gets it. He sees it. They should be welcomed. And then we read that Peter stayed with them for some days. We don't know how long. Presumably Cornelius wanted to learn more about Jesus, not because what he had heard wasn't sufficient, but that he just wanted to grow more and more. And I think the same should be true of us, is if we don't have a hunger to learn more about Jesus, then we probably don't fully grasp who Jesus is. Well, we never fully grasp. But I guess we're not seeing the beauty of who Jesus is. And so we need to read Scripture. We need to study and see God's character revealed to us, because in that we see the beauty of a God who loves us, who planned salvation right from the beginning so that we would be restored together with God's people, united in purpose and in meaning to declare the gospel to the nations. Okay, so let's go to chapter 11 here. And I'm just going to make a couple of comments here. But I want to read this text again, because this is God's inspired word written for us, so we don't want to skip it. Chapter 11, verse 1 says, "Now the apostles and the brothers who were throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcision party critiqued him, saying, 'You went to uncircumcised men and ate with them?' But Peter began and explained it to them in order. 'I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision, something like a great sheet descending, being let down from heaven by its four corners, and it came down to me. Looking at it closely, I observed animals and beasts of prey and reptiles and birds of the air. I heard a voice saying to me, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But I said, 'By no means, Lord, for nothing common or unclean has ever entered my mouth.' But the voice answered a second time from heaven, 'What God has made clean, do not call common.' This happened three times, and all was drawn up again into heaven. And behold, at that very moment, three men arrived at the house in which we were, sent to me from Caesarea, and the Spirit told me to go with them, making no distinction. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen the angel stand in his house and say, 'Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will declare to you a message by which you will be saved.'" You notice that? Not might, that you will be saved by this message. "You will be saved, you and all your household. As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell on them just as on us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, 'John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' If then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when he believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way?" When they heard these things, they fell silent. They glorified God, saying, "Then to the Gentiles also God has granted repentance that leads to life." So it's interesting, because there's this group of Jewish people, right? And the fact that they're called the circumcision party seems to indicate that there was kind of this nationalistic sense in them, that the Jews are God's people, not anybody else. And people were always, in the Old Testament, you could become a Jew. You had to go through the process of circumcision. You had to, you know, observe the Torah. You had to do the ceremonial eating and cleaning and washing, all those kinds of things. You could be welcomed into the Jewish family, but you had to do those things. And that seems to be what this group is going. It's like, well, you can't eat with unclean people. They got to fix their sin. They got to deal with their stuff first, and then they can be welcomed into us, which we know is the exact opposite of the gospel. The gospel is that we come to God with our sin, we repent of that sin, and he forgives us. We don't fix our lives first. We can't. That's why we need a savior. And so this circumcision party is upset with Peter. Now, I think it's important to note this, is it's not as though, how do I say this? It's not as though that it's Peter against these group of people. Is in all likelihood, when Peter last spoke with these groups of Jewish people, he believed the same thing. That yeah, Gentiles would be preached to, but they would need to come to the Jewish faith first. And through this vision that he had now seen on the, before going to Cornelius, is he was starting to see and understand that that was not the case. Because it was God who orchestrated their salvation. It was God who poured out the Holy Spirit on them at the Gentile Pentecost. It was God who was doing these things, not Peter. And so when they opposed him, I think there should be a little bit of sympathy in the sense of like, they're going, Peter, you've abandoned us here. Like, you used to believe the same thing we did. And I think this is what happens with the gospel of Jesus. Is the gospel of Jesus is radical. It means that we're to love our enemies, to pray for those who persecute you, to wish well to those people. When we're attacked so often, we demand justice. But what we should be praying for is that they would encounter Jesus, not so that our suffering stops, but so that they would see who Jesus is. And I think that's a hard thing for us from time to time, or maybe often. But here, Peter is now in this tricky spot. And so I like how he words it. He says in verse 4. But Peter began and explained it to them in order. It's like, okay, guys, hold on. Here's what happened. And then he tells the story. I was over here doing my own thing. A vision came to me, declaring to me a radical truth. And I said, no, I'm not going to eat this. But it happened 3 times. Do not call uncommon or unclean what God has declared clean. And so for him to process that and see that, that was a challenge for him. And then when he went, and now he says, it's not just me. These 6 other Jewish people, they came with me. And God told me that I was to preach a gospel that would bring them to salvation. And it had nothing to do with the ceremonial food laws. It had nothing to do with observance of the laws. It had everything to do with confession, repentance, and then an indwelling of the Spirit to walk in Jesus, to walk new in Jesus. And so he lays that out for them. There's something that I couldn't get up. I couldn't help but not see this week. When Peter says here in verse 15, as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell on them just as on us at the beginning. And I remember the word of the Lord, how John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. If then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus, who was I that I could stand in God's way? I think that's a very important sentence for a couple of reasons. One is I think Peter's recognizing that salvation is a work of God, not a work of us. That's important. That we would see that it's Christ that saves us. That it's not because we are good in and of ourselves that we're worth saving, but because God loves us and he has offered us a chance at redemption through the blood of Jesus. But then secondly, he also goes, there's a couple of times where he unifies himself with them. The Holy Spirit fell on them just as on us at the beginning. If then God gave the same gift to them that he gave to us, he's identifying them together, which I think is very important. He's beginning to see and understand the unity that exists there. But then, and this I think is, this was the biggest one for me this week as I was studying. When he says, if then, verse 17, God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us, when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way? And I was reminded back of something that we read back in chapter 5, when Peter and the apostles are declaring the good news of Jesus, at this point still just to the Jewish people. And the Jewish religious leaders are very upset because they have rejected Jesus as Messiah. But this movement is growing, and the religious leaders are scared. They're worried about what's going to happen. And a man named Gamaliel says, this is verse 35, 38, 39. He says, men of Israel, take care what you are about to do with these men, Peter and the apostles. If this plan or undertaking is of man, it will fail. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them. And then he says this, verse 39, you might even be found opposing God. And now we have that same thing here in chapter 11. And I think there's significance there because Gamaliel, we don't know very much about him. But we see the wisdom. We see the wisdom in him recognizing that if this is of God, then he needs to get on board with that. He needs to allow God to be God and him to be a human that submits to God. And he says, if it is of God, we won't be able to overthrow it, and then we'll be found opposing God. And so what Peter is saying here is in the same way, he's saying, look what God did. He brought the Holy Spirit. He indwelled them. They are united. This Gentile group is united in fellowship with us. We are the same. And I don't dare stand in God's way opposing God who brings who he will to faith in Jesus Christ. I think that's important for us. It's important for us because I think, again, we sometimes really want justice. When we read an article online about some awful tragedy that happened, or we see someone doing some awful things to people in our world, children, whatever it might be, it can be so easy to call out for God's righteous vindication and judgment, when what we should be calling out for is recognizing that God loves them and God wants to bring them to salvation. Now they have to either choose to repent or not, but you and I need to bear witness. Like I said earlier, we are commissioned, but Peter goes even further and says we are commanded to declare the good news of Jesus. So let me go back to something I said right at the beginning as we close here. Has Jesus radically changed you? Or is Jesus just a part of your life that really doesn't make your life look a whole bunch different, other than maybe you go to church on Sunday, maybe you go to Bible study on a certain weeknight, maybe you attend a prayer meeting from time to time? But has he changed your heart? Has he radically changed who you are and so that how you think, how you see people, how you respond to situations is different? Have you been given a new heart? Because that's what it means to know Christ. That's what it means to repent and turn towards him. And that's my prayer for us, that we would see and that we would understand that. Thank you for bearing with me with this. I actually don't know that you did. Maybe the tech didn't work and everybody went home early. No idea. I guess I'll find out later in the week. But let me pray for us as we go. God, thank you that you are a God who loves us, and you have made a way for us to be brought to Jesus so that we can be forgiven of our sins, so that your righteousness can be imputed into us, and so that we can be with you for all of eternity in perfection. God, may we really understand the gospel. May that change how we live in every aspect of our life. When we face temptation, when we face uncertainty, when we face hurt or confusion, may we respond in a whole different way because of the love of Jesus Christ. And may we seek to share that love of Jesus Christ with everyone that we meet. God, give us the courage and the boldness to do that. Thank you for all that you're doing. Thank you for this church, for this group of people, for those that have come today. Bless them as we go from this place. We love you. Thank you for salvation. Amen. All right, well, I hope you have a great week, and I look forward to actually seeing you next week, because I tell you, it's too much deja vu for me. Have a wonderful week, everyone. Bye-bye.